Hello, my dear students. Welcome back to your channel. Hope you all are doing well. Today, I am going to start one short revision of chapter 11, that is thermal properties of matter. This chapter is not so important from examination point of view, but the concepts of this chapter are used in thermodynamics, which is next of this chapter, right? So you must revise this chapter also. Different topics to be covered in this chapter are what is heat and temperature, then thermal expansion of solid, liquids and gases, anomalous expansion of water, which is all very, very important, then a specific heat capacity, calorimetry, change of state, that is latent heat capacity, then thermal conductivity, black body radiation, waste displacement law, Stefan's law, and greenhouse effect. All these topics are very, very small, right? So, first of all, what does this chapter mean? Thermal properties of matter. Thermal means what? Thermal means heat, right? So, in this chapter, you study about different properties of matter that are related to heat. So, first of all, you must know about heat, then what is temperature. After that, we discuss all these topics one by one, right? So, first, what is heat, right? Heat is a form of energy which produces in us sensation of hotness or coldness. Suppose you put some ice on your hand, what happens? You feel cold. Why you feel cold? Because energy, heat energy transfers from your hand to ice and temperature of your hand decreases and you feel cold. Suppose if you touch hot coffee or tea, what happens? You feel hot. Why? Because heat flows from hot coffee or tea to your hand and temperature of hand increases and you feel hot. So it is just a sensation of hotness or coldness and it only flows due to temperature difference between the two body, right? So it flows due to temperature difference between the two bodies. Suppose the two bodies have same temperature and if these two bodies are present thermal contact with each other, what happens? If T1 is equal to T2, then there is no flow of it. It only flows due to temperature difference between the two body. When any body is heated, its molecular vibration becomes fast and its kinetic energy increases, right now? There are different types of motion in any body, vibratory motion, translatory motion, oscillatory motion. So, their kinetic energy increases due to all types of motion. So, heat is nothing but it is total kinetic energy of the body. Hope it's clear to all of you what is heat. It is a form of energy, so its unit is same as that of the energy. A unit of heat is joule. And CGS system calorie and 1 calorie is equal to 1.4186 joule or near about 4.2 joule, right? Now, how you define 1 calorie? Actually, 1 calorie is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of a substance through 1 degree Celsius, right? Okay, hope it's clear to all of you and must remember this relation, 1 calorie equal to 4.2 joule. Now, next important term is temperature. What is this temperature? To measure this heat, we need a quantity that is temperature. Temperature is nothing but measure of degree of hotness or coldness of a body. How much any body is hot or cold, to measure this hotness or coldness of a body with the help of this temperature, right? It decides direction of flow of heat energy. In which direction heat energy flows, it always flows from higher temperature to lower temperature, right? So this temperature decides direction of flow of heat energy and it represents average kinetic energy of the body. You must remember this point is heat is total kinetic energy of the body and this temperature is average kinetic energy of the body. It is measured in degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit, Kelvin, there are different units to measure temperature, right? After this temperature, to measure this temperature, we need a device and that device is called thermometer. It is a device that measures temperature. Now, what is the basic principle of this thermometer? In any type of thermometer, there are different types of thermometer like mercury thermometer, platinum resistance thermometer, constant volume gas thermometer, constant pressure gas thermometer. There are different types of thermometer. In all types of thermometer, what happens when you supply some heat? It means when you increase the temperature, what happens? Any one property of the liquid changes, like length of the liquid column, resistance, pressure, volume, any one physical quantity changes with the increase in temperature. And this is the basic principle of thermometer. It is based on uniform variation of some physical property with heat, or you can say temperature, like length, pressure, volume and resistance, etc. This is the basic principle of thermometer. Now, to measure temperature, we need temperature scale. There are different types of temperature scale, like Celsius scale, Fahrenheit scale, Kelvin scale. But in all types of temperature scale, we need two fixed points. One is called lower fixed point and another one is called upper fixed point. This lower fixed point is called ice point and upper fixed point is called boiling point. Now, depending on this ice point and boiling point, there are different types of temperature scales to measure temperature, right? So please take a screenshot of this one, then we will discuss next temperature scale. Now, temperature scale or thermometric scale. You know, to measure temperature, we need temperature scale, and there are different types of temperature scale depending upon ice point and boiling point. What is this ice point? In any type of temperature scale, there are two fixed points. One is called ice point or lower fixed point, and the one is called boiling point or upper fixed point. Ice point means freezing point, at temperature at which water, pure water, freezes. And boiling point is also called steam point, upper fixed point, at which water, pure water, boils. So in any type of temperature scale, there are two fixed points. This one is Celsius scale, Fahrenheit scale and Kelvin scale. In Celsius scale, ice point is 0 degree Celsius and steam point is 100 degree Celsius. And difference between this steam and ice point is what? 100 minus 0, 100. So entire scale is divided into 100 equal parts. In case of Fahrenheit scale, ice point is 32 degree Fahrenheit and steam point is 212 degree Fahrenheit. And difference between these two is what? 180. So in here, entire scale is divided into 180 equal parts. Now come to Kelvin scale. In Kelvin scale, ice point is 273 degree Kelvin and steam point is, or boiling point is 373 degree Kelvin. It means difference is what? 100. So here also entire scale divided into 100 equal parts. Now how you convert from one scale to another scale? There is one important formula for this one. Conversion of temperature from one scale to another scale. This one is very, very important formula. You must remember this formula, right? What is this? Temperature on one scale minus ice point divided by boiling point minus ice point equal to temperature on other scale minus ice point divided by boiling point minus ice point. Here difference between the two fixed point, and in numerator, temperature on one scale minus ice point. So relation among different temperature scale, you can write in this way. Temperature on one scale, suppose I am taking Celsius scale, right? So you write here C minus, in Celsius scale ice point is what? 0 divided by boiling point is what? 100, and ice point is 0. So 100 minus 0 equal to Fahrenheit scale. So you write F minus ice point is what? 32 divided by difference between the two fixed point, 212 minus 32 equal to Kelvin scale K minus 273 divided by 373 minus 273. After calculating this one, you get C by 100 equal to F minus 32 by 180 equal to K by minus 273 by 100. This is a general formula to convert one scale into another scale. C by 100 equal to F minus 32 by 180 equal to K minus 273 by 100. From this relation, you can convert one scale into another scale. For example, you want to convert Celsius into Kelvin. So you equate these two, right? If you want to convert Celsius into Fahrenheit, you use to these two. If you want to convert Fahrenheit into Kelvin, you use these two, right? So you can write in this way. Suppose I want to write a relation between Celsius and Kelvin. So you write C by 100 equal to K minus 273 by 100. C by 100 minus K minus 273 by 100. This 100 cancel. C equal to K minus 273, or K equal to C plus 273. This is the relation between C and K, Celsius and Kelvin. In the same way, relation between Celsius and Fahrenheit. You write these two equations, right? C by 100 equal to F minus 32 by 180. The 0, 0 cancel, 2 5s are 2 9s are. It becomes 5 by 9. So C equal to 5 by 9, bracket me, M minus F minus 32. This ratio between C and F. In this way, you convert from one scale into another scale. And this is the general relation. And this is general formula for all the three scales, right? And there is one temperature at which all scales have same temperature. That is called minus 40 degrees Celsius. at -40°C, all scales have same temperature. You must remember this point also. So hope it's clear to all of you what are different types of scale, then how you convert one scale into another scale. There is one term that is absolute zero temperature. What is this? Absolute zero temperature. It is minimum temperature of an ideal gas at which pressure and volume becomes zero and entire molecular motion stops. Entire molecular motion stops. This minimum temperature of an ideal gas where entire molecular motion stops and pressure and volume becomes zero is called absolute zero temperature. It is at -273°C or 0 Kelvin, right? So this 0 Kelvin or -273°C is called absolute zero temperature where entire molecular motion stops. Hope it's clear to all of you. Please take a screenshot of this one. Then we move to the next topic, that is thermal expansion. Next topic is thermal expansion. What is thermal expansion? Almost all substance, whether it is solid, liquid or gases, when it is heated, it expands on heating. Why? You know, all substance made up of atoms or molecules, when it is heated, what happens? It molecules starts vibrating, atoms starts vibrating and their intermolecular separation increases, right? So due to increasing intermolecular separation between the molecules, the substance starts expanding. So this is called thermal expansion. Increase in size of a body due to increase in its temperature or when it is heated, same thing, right? Any one thing, increase in its temperature or when it is heated, this is called thermal expansion. Now when a substance is heated, there are three types of thermal expansion. Either its length increases, its area increases or its volume increases. Depending on this, there are three types of thermal expansion. First one is linear expansion. This is increase in length due to increase in temperature. Next one is superficial areal expansion. It is increase in area due to increase in temperature. And third one is cubical expansion or volumetric expansion. When a substance is heated, there is increase in volume due to increase in temperature. So on the basis of which dimension increases, whether length, area or volume, there are three types of thermal expansion. And when a substance is cooled, when its temperature decreases, in place of expansion, it starts contracting. That is called negative thermal expansion. When a substance contracts on decreasing its temperature, when it is cooled, it starts contracting, its dimension decreases. That is called negative thermal expansion, right? So first is, on the basis of this linear expansion, there is increase in length due to increase in temperature. From there you get coefficient of linear expansion. Suppose this is the length of original object AB at temperature T. When you increase, when you heat it, there is increase in temperature by delta T amount. So its length becomes L dash when temperature becomes T dash. T dash is original temperature plus increase in temperature. So there is increase in length delta L due to increase in temperature delta T. L is original length, L dash is final length, and change in length is how much? Delta L is equal to L dash minus L, and delta T is increase in temperature. Now this increase in size of object, increase in length, depends on which factors? It depends on the original dimension, what is the original length, and also up to which extent it is heated, what is the increase in temperature. So this increase in length is directly proportional to increase in temperature. Greater the increase in temperature, greater the length increase. And also it is directly proportional to original length. If original length is larger, then increase in length is also large. So it depends on these two, increase in temperature, original length. So this increase in length is directly proportional to original length and increase in temperature. You remove this proportionality constant, you get delta L equal to alpha L L delta T. What is this alpha? And in base L it is written. What is this alpha? It is coefficient of linear expansion. From here you get alpha L equal to delta L by L delta T. Delta L is increase in length, L is original length, and delta T is increase in temperature or rise in temperature. From here you can define coefficient of linear expansion. This it is increase in length per unit original length per degree rise in temperature. So this is coefficient of linear expansion. What is unit? Increase in length by original length, both cancel each other, only rise in temperature is left in the denominator. It means per degree Celsius or per degree Kelvin is its unit. You can write in these two units, right? So this is about coefficient linear expansion. In the same way, when area increases, in that case coefficient of areal expansion. When volume increases, coefficient of volume expansion, right? So first you take a screenshot of this one, then we will discuss that things. Now, after coefficient of linear expansion, next is coefficient of superficial or areal expansion. When a body is heated, its area increases due to increase in temperature. That is called linear expansion. An increase in area is directly proportional to increase in temperature and directly proportional to original area. So, increase in area is directly proportional to A delta T. It becomes delta A equal to alpha A delta T. This alpha A is called coefficient of superficial expansion or areal expansion, right? And how you define this one? Coefficient of superficial expansion, it is equal to increase in area per unit original area per degree rise in temperature. And its unit is also, because this ratio of area no dimension, only rise in temperature in the denominator. So per degree Kelvin or per degree Celsius is its unit. Next, coefficient of cubical expansion. Due to increase in temperature, when a body is heated, its volume increases. And that increase in volume is directly proportional to increase in temperature, directly proportional to original volume. And it becomes delta V equal to alpha V, V delta T. This alpha V equal to delta V by V delta T. Increase in volume by original volume. And this one is rise in temperature. This one is coefficient of cubical expansion, right? Volume expansion. And how you define this one? It is equal to increase in volume per unit original volume per degree rise in temperature. Its unit is also per Kelvin or per degree Celsius, right? So these are coefficient of linear, superficial, volume, cubical expansion. Now, what is the relation between these three types of coefficient of linear, superficial, cubical expansion? So for this, consider a volume cube, consider a cube, each side of length L. So original volume of this cube is what? V equal to L cube. Now if it if temperature increases by delta T amount, then length of each side increases by delta L amount, then there is increase in volume by delta V amount. So what is the increase in volume due to increase in temperature by delta T? Original volume, increase in volume, increase volume is this V dash and original volume is V. So increase volume is its dimension increases by delta L, na? So increase in volume is also L plus delta L whole cube minus original volume is L cube. So you put here formula A plus B cube, A cube plus B cube plus 3AB A plus B. Use mathematical formula and you open this one, A plus B, L plus delta L whole cube. It becomes this one. Now here, again you open it this one, L cube plus delta L cube plus 3L square. You multiply this one, L square delta L plus 3L delta L square minus L cube. This L cube cancel. As change in length is very small, so delta L square delta L cube is also very very small, and you can neglect this term also, delta L cube, and also here delta L square. Then delta V becomes, only this term is left, right? 3L square delta L, equation number 2. And equation number 1 is original volume is L cube and increased in volume is 3L square delta L. Now you know coefficient of cubical or volume expansion is what? Delta V by V delta T. Delta V is 3L square delta L divided by original volume is L cube. This V is L cube and delta T. From here, 2L cancel, it becomes 3 delta L by L delta T. And you know 3 delta L by L delta T is what? coefficient of linear expansion alpha n. So you write alpha v equal to 3 alpha n. This is relation between coefficient of volume expansion, coefficient of linear expansion. In the same way, if area of this cube increases, then you find increase in volume. In place of increase in volume, you find increase in area, and you get this relation alpha A equal to 2 alpha L. And from these two, equation number 3 and 4, you get a relation alpha L equal to this alpha L, alpha A by 2, and here alpha L is alpha V by 3. So alpha L equal to alpha A by 2 equal to alpha V by 2. This is very, very important relation between these three types of expansion. Coefficient of cubical expansion, linear expansion, and superficial expansion. Hope it's clear to all of you. Please take a screenshot of this one. Then we'll move to the next topic. Now, practical applications of thermal expansion. You know what is thermal expansion, what are its different types. Now, what are its different applications, right? First one is a small gap is left between the iron rails of railway track. Why a small gap is left between the rails of railway track? The two rails are attached with plate. Now, if no space is left between the rails, now what happens? During summer, it expands and the rail may get derailed. That's why a small gap is always left between the two rails of railway track. Second one is space is left between the girders used for supporting bridges. It is also due to thermal expansion. Some space is left between the girders, right? Next is clock pendulums are made of invar. Invar is an alloy. What happens if this alloy invar has small temperature coefficient of expansion? So during summer season or change of state, the length of the pendulum remains unchanged and the clock gives current time. That's why the clock pendulum are made up of invar. It is an alloy and it has small temperature coefficient of expansion, so it always gives correct time. There is no effect of thermal expansion or change of state. And the last one is a glass stopper jammed in the neck of a glass bottle can be removed by warming the neck of the bottle. What happens when you heat the neck of the bottle? What happens? Thermal expansion takes place and its mouth becomes wider and the stopper becomes loose and it can easily comes out, right? Now that's why we always warm the neck of the bottle so that it can easily comes out. Now after this, next important topic is anomalous expansion of water. Anomalous means some different behavior. You know, any substance is heated, thermal expansion takes place on heating and contraction takes place on cooling. But water behaves some different manner between 0 degree Celsius to 4 degree Celsius. Water contracts on heating between 0 and 4 degree Celsius. Between 0 to 4 degree Celsius, when you heat the water, it contracts on heating in place of expansion. Or you can say it expands when cooled from 4 degree Celsius to 0 degree Celsius. When water is cooled from 4 degree to 0 degree Celsius, in place of contraction, expansion takes place. So water behaves in a different manner. This is called anomalous expansion of water. And it is only due to hydrogen bonding of water molecules. You study chemical details in chemistry, right? Now, so no need to study that one. Only you just know that there is some anomalous expansion of water between 0 and 4 degree Celsius. So this is the gap between volume, temperature and density temperature. What happens when you heat the water? Its temperature increases and in place of expansion, contraction takes place and its volume decreases. And if volume decreases, it means its density increases from 0 to 4 degrees Celsius. So when temperature increases between 0 to 4, its volume decreases and its density increases, right? And when after this, above 4 degrees Celsius, what happens? Again, expansion takes place. Expansion takes place means temperature increases, volume increases above 4 degrees Celsius. If volume increases, density decreases above 4 degrees Celsius. So this is graph between volume temperature and density temperature. From these graphs, you find that at 4 degrees Celsius, there is maximum density in water. Right? So this is anomalous expansion of water, and at 4 degrees Celsius there is maximum density of water. There are different application of this anomalous expansion of water. First one is, in cold countries water pipes are burst. Why water pipes are burst? In cold countries during winter time, when a temperature below 4 degrees Celsius takes place, what happens? Thermal expansion takes place in place of contraction, and water pipe, it exerts pressure on the pipe and the pipe gets burst, right? Now, so in cold countries water pipes are burst. Second one, at cold nights crops are destroyed. What happens in cold nights? The nerves or capillaries gets burst due to expansion of water below 4 degrees Celsius. And the last application, very important application, is ice freezes only at lake surface, and hence aquatic creatures can live below surface. In winter season or in cold countries, aquatic creatures can live below surface due to this anomalous expansion of water. What happens when temperature decreases up to 4 degrees Celsius? Water starts contracting and its volume decreases and its density increases up to 4 degrees Celsius. Density increases means the large denser water settles down, and the water at the warm water, which is less dense at the bottom, it starts rising up. This takes place up to 4 degrees Celsius, right? Now, below 4 degrees Celsius, what happens? In place of contraction, expansion takes place. Below 4 degrees, volume increases, density decreases. Now, the water at the surface becomes less dense and it remains at the surface. And when the temperature reaches below water 0 degrees Celsius, the water starts freezing at the surface and converted into ice. Now, you know, but the water below the surface remains at 4 degrees Celsius, right? Now, and I know this ice which is formed near the surface is a poor conductor of heat, so no heat transfer from this water inside the lake to the atmosphere, and the aquatic animals which are living inside this water can live below the surface. So this is the best example of anomalous expansion of water. It is good for aquatic creatures. Hope it's clear to all of you. Please take a screenshot of this one. Then we move to the next topic. Now, next topic is a specific heat. What is a specific heat? Actually, heat are of two types, right? One is a specific heat and another one is latent heat. One is a specific heat and another one is latent heat. Latent heat I will discuss after this one, this topic, right? So what is this specific heat? When a body is heated, what happens? Its temperature rises. So the amount of heat given to any body is directly proportional to its mass and temperature rise, right? The amount of heat given to any body, delta Q, is directly proportional to mass of the body and temperature rise, delta T, right? Okay, and when you remove this proportionality constant, it becomes delta Q equal to mc delta T. So this small c is called a specific heat, or you can say a specific heat capacity. How you define this specific heat? If m is 1, delta T is 1, then C equal to delta Q. So in this way, you define specific heat from this equation is that it is amount of heat required to raise the temperature of unit mass of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. It is amount of heat required to raise the temperature of unit mass of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. This is called specific heat, and it depends on nature of the substance and temperature. Its SI unit is joule. This in delta Q is in joule, mass is in kg, and this temperature in Kelvin. So joule per kg per Kelvin, and CGS unit calorie per gram per degree Celsius. Actually, this topic is important in next chapter, so I will discuss in detail in thermodynamics, right? In thermodynamics, this topic is very important. Now, next is molar specific heat or molar specific heat capacity. What is this? Only a minute difference between this specific heat and molar specific heat. Here, unit mass, and here in place of mass, unit mole, right? So, amount of heat required to raise temperature of unit mole of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. Delta Q is equal to, this mu is mole, this capital C is what? Molar space between, delta T is rise in temperature. So this is denoted by capital C and it is equal to delta Q by mu delta T, right? If mu is 1, delta T is 1, then C equal to delta Q. So this molar specific heat is equal to amount of heat required to raise temperature of unit mole of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. SI unit is joule per mole per Kelvin and CGS system calorie per mole per Kelvin, right? Sorry, not per Kelvin, per degree Celsius. So in detail, this topic also discuss in thermodynamics. This is also of two types. One is molar specific capacity at constant pressure, and another one is at constant volume. How you define these two, what is the relation between these two? I will discuss all these things in thermodynamics, right? After this, next topic is heat capacity or thermal capacity. It is amount of heat required to raise the temperature of whole body through 1 degree Celsius. Here, unit mass of a substance. Here, whole body. How much amount of heat is required to raise the temperature of the whole body by 1 degree Celsius? For unit mass, this one is for whole body, H equal to M into C. This small c is what? Small c is specific heat capacity. Specific heat capacity. And capital C is molar specific heat capacity. So this is H equal to M into C. And when you put the value of C, it becomes delta Q by delta T. If delta T is 1, H equal to delta Q. So it is equal to amount of heat required to raise the temperature of whole body by 1 degree Celsius. Its SI unit is joule per Kelvin and CGS system calorie per degree Celsius. Now after this, next topic is calorimetry. What is this calorimetry? It is a branch of physics that deals with measurement of heat, and the device which is used to measure heat is called calorimeter. Now, what is the basic principle of this calorimetry? The principle of this calorimetry is the amount of heat gained by a body which is kept at lower temperature is equal to amount of heat lost by a body which is kept at higher temperature. Heat always flows from higher temperature to lower temperature, and those body which is kept at higher temperature, it always lost heat, and those body which is kept at lower temperature, it always gain heat. So the amount of heat gained by a body at lower temperature is equal to amount of heat lost by a hot body, provided there is no exchange of heat between the surroundings. So this is principle of calorimetry, and it is in consequence of the law of conservation of energy, and this principle is used to solve many problems related to calorimetry. So these are about specific heat capacity, molar specific heat, principle of calorimetry, right? After this, please take a screenshot of this one. After this, we'll discuss latent heat and change of state. Now, next topic is change of state or transition of state. Change of state from one form to another form. There are three states, mainly three states, solid, liquid and gas. Solid means ice, liquid means water, and gas means vapor state, right? So there are three states, solid, liquid and gas or vapor. Now what happens when you heat the solid, you increase the temperature, then this solid changes into liquid state, and this process is called melting. Change of state from solid to liquid on heating is called melting. First one is melting. Now again you increase the temperature to this liquid. Now this liquid changes into vapor state, and this change of liquid into vapor on heating is called vaporization. Now reverse process, when you cool this liquid to solid, right, then this process is called freezing or fusion. When you cool this vapor, it changes into liquid, and this process of changing from vapor to liquid state on cooling is called condensation. So this one is third process and this one is fourth process. One more, solid directly changes into vapor state, and this process is called sublimation. So there are three processes of change of state: melting, vaporization, condensation, freezing or fusion, and sublimation. You must remember this change of states and what is the name of that process when one state changes into another states. Now there is a graph with me, temperature and this time. At 0 degrees Celsius, suppose this is a 0 degrees Celsius. This when you heat this solid, it changes into liquid at 0 degrees Celsius. And this change in state from solid to liquid is called melting, right? Now again you heat this liquid and then temperature increases and it reaches up to 100 degrees Celsius. At 100 degrees Celsius, then this liquid starts changing into vapor state, and this process is called vaporization. One more thing, when there is a change of state from one to another, solid into liquid, this takes place at constant temperature, right? Solid into liquid takes place at constant temperature. There is no change in temperature. It means what? This temperature at which solid and liquid state coexist in thermal equilibrium during melting process or change of state from solid to liquid is called melting point. What is melting point? The temperature at which this solid and liquid exist in thermal equilibrium, both exist in the same temperature. Thermal equilibrium means same temperature, means if the bodies are at same temperature with thermal equilibrium, then this temperature is called melting point. And how it depends on pressure, when you increase the pressure, melting point also increases. Now this temperature at which liquid changes into vapor during this vaporization process, this temperature at which liquid and vapor exist in thermal equilibrium, this temperature is called boiling point. The temperature at which liquid and vapor state coexist thermal equilibrium during vaporization process or change of state from liquid into vapor is called boiling point. So this one, during melting process, this temperature is melting point, and during vaporization process, this temperature is boiling point. When you increase the pressure, boiling point also increases. Now one more thing, next topic is latent heat. What is this? During transition of state from one into another, solid into liquid, there is no change in temperature. It takes place at constant temperature. It means when you heat this solid, it absorbs, the substance absorbs the heat to change into liquid state at constant temperature, and that heat is called latent heat. This heat absorbed during this process is called latent heat. Same thing during liquid to vapor. When substance changes state into from liquid to vapor state, it takes place at constant temperature, so it absorbs heat. When you heat the liquid, it changes into vapor state without changing temperature, and this, the amount of heat which is given to this liquid is called latent heat, hidden heat, right? So how you define this latent heat? The quantity of heat required to change the state of unit mass of a substance at constant temperature and pressure. When this change of state takes place, it takes place at constant temperature and pressure, then that amount of heat is called latent heat. Its formula is Q equal to ML, and this L equal to Q by M. L is called latent heat of substance. This Q is amount of heat given to the system, and M is mass of the substance. So its SI unit is joule per kg, or in CGS system, calorie per gram. This is the formula for latent heat, right? So hope you understood what do you mean by latent heat. Now these are of two types. During melting process, it means change of state from solid to liquid, the amount of heat absorbed at constant temperature and pressure is called latent heat of fusion or latent heat of melting. And at this one, the amount of heat absorbed during change of state from liquid to vapor at constant temperature and pressure is called latent heat of vaporization. So this is of two types, latent heat of fusion and latent heat of vaporization. The amount of heat required to change the state from solid to liquid of unit mass of a substance at constant temperature and pressure is called latent heat of fusion. And latent heat of vaporization, it takes place at 100 degrees Celsius. The amount of heat required to change the state of unit mass of a substance from liquid to vapor at constant temperature and pressure is called latent heat of vaporization. Hope it's clear to all of you. There are two types of heat, latent heat and specific heat. So during latent heat, there is change of state at constant temperature. What is specific heat? The amount of heat required to change the temperature of unit mass of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. This one is a specific heat, right? Specific heat of a substance. During this specific heat, this temperature changes from when during this state is not changing. State is same liquid to liquid. When you supply some heat, then temperature increases, right? From this to this. So the amount of heat, heat is given to this one. And there is change in temperature. The amount of heat given to a substance to change the temperature of unit mass through 1 degree Celsius. This is called specific heat. This one is also called specific heat, right? Hope it's clear to all of you. What do you mean by latent heat? During latent heat, there is change of state at constant temperature. During a specific heat, there is change of temperature at constant state. There is no change in state, right? So hope it's clear to all of you. Please take a screenshot of this one. Then we'll move to the next topic. Now, modes of transfer of heat. There are different methods of heat transfer from one place to another place. Actually, this topic is not in your syllabus, but you must know about different methods of heat transfer because thermal conductivity is in your syllabus. So there are three processes of heat transfer, that is conduction, convection and radiation. This conduction takes place in solids and in fluids, it means liquids and gases, convection takes place, and radiation in which there is no medium is required. So first, what do we mean by this conduction? It is a process in which heat is transmitted from one part of a body to another at a lower temperature through molecular collision. This term is very, very important. Heat transfer from one part of a body to another part at lower temperature through molecular collision. In here, particle is not moving from one place to here. Particle just collides, and due to molecular collision, heat transfer from one part of the body to another part without any actual flow of matter or particle. Suppose this is a metal rod, it is heated at this end, right? So heat flows from this end to this end through molecular collision without any actual flow of matter, right? So this is conduction, it takes place in solids. Now, what do you mean by this thermal conductivity? Suppose this metal rod is heated, is of length X, and heat flows from this end to this one. At this end, temperature is T1, and this end temperature is T2. And then T1 is greater than T2. This A is area of cross-section, and heat flows from this end to this end in time T. So let Q be the amount of heat flows in time T, and this flow of heat in time T is directly proportional to area of cross-section of the conductor, directly proportional to difference of the two ends of the temperature, directly proportional to time, inversely proportional to length of the conductor. When you combine these two, you get Q equal to Ka T2 minus T1 T by X. And from here, K equal to QX by A T2 minus T1 into T. This K is called coefficient of thermal conductivity. And how you define this coefficient of thermal conductivity? If area is 1, T2 minus T1 is 1, T is 1 and X is 1, then K equal to Q. It means coefficient of thermal conductivity is equal to quantity of heat flows in unit time through a unit cube when the opposite ends of the cube are kept at a temperature difference of 1 degree Celsius. In this way, you define coefficient of thermal conductivity. This topic is important. It may come in 1 or 2 marks. And this SI unit of K is what? This is joule. This heat is in joule per meter per second per Kelvin. And its dimension is mLT minus 3 K minus 1. How you find the dimension? This heat is energy. Do you know the dimension of energy? X meter, area, temperature is in Kelvin, time is in second. From that one, you get dimension mLT minus 3 K minus 1. Next mode of heat transfer is convection. Convection is the process in which heat flows from a region of higher temperature to a lower temperature by actual movement of particle. Here, particle is not actually moving when heat flows from one end of the object to another. But here, there is actual movement of matter. So this is convection, in which heat flows from region of higher temperature to lower temperature by actual movement of the matter. For example, formation of land and sea bridge. Now last one is radiation. Radiation is a mode of heat transfer in which no medium is required. In these two, conduction and convection, medium is required, but in this radiation, no medium is required. It is a process by which heat is transmitted from one place to another without heating the intervening media. For example, heat from sun reaches the earth by radiation process. So these are different modes of heat transfer of heat, and in this one, thermal conductivity is important. Please take a screenshot of this one. Then we'll move to the next topic. Next is Newton's law of cooling. What is this? It is related to cooling of hot bodies in air. For example, if you keep hot coffee or tea in air, what happens? It becomes cool after some time. Why? Because there is exchange of heat from hot coffee or tea to the surroundings due to temperature difference between the two systems. And this is related to Newton's law of cooling. According to this law, it states that the rate of loss of heat, it means rate of cooling of a body, is directly proportional to temperature difference between the body and its surroundings. Suppose there is a hot body having temperature T and there is a surrounding having temperature T naught. Now, heat transfer from this hot body to this surrounding due to temperature difference between the body and the surrounding, and this body starts losing heat and it becomes cool. So rate of loss of heat or cooling is directly proportional to temperature difference between the body and its surrounding, provided temperature difference is very, very small. This here, suppose T is greater than T naught. So you can write rate of loss of heat means dq by dt. It is directly proportional to temperature difference between the body and its surrounding, T minus T naught. Why I have taken here negative sign? Because it denotes rate of loss of heat. So you put here minus. Minus dq by dt is directly proportional to T minus T by T minus T naught. This represents rate of loss of heat. And this is temperature difference between body and surrounding. Now we come to the last part of this chapter. It is very, very small, just definition and a statement you know. What is black body? Black body are those bodies which neither reflects nor transmits but absorbs whole of heat radiations incident on it. Suppose heat radiation incident on a body, then it absorbs all heat incident on the body. It neither reflects nor transmits. That type of body is called black body, right? And what do you mean by black body radiation? Now suppose this black body is heated, then what happens? It starts emitting radiations. Then the radiation emitted by black body is called black body radiation, right? And on the basis of this black body, there are two laws, Stefan-Boltzmann's law and Wien's displacement law. According to this law, on a statement you know, right? Total energy radiated by a perfect black body. When a black body is heated, it starts emitting radiations. Then the total energy radiated by a perfect black body per second per unit area is directly proportional to fourth power of its absolute temperature. It means E is directly proportional to T to the power 4. You can write E equal to sigma T to the power 4, where sigma is called Stefan's constant. Its value is 5.67 into 10 minus 8 joule per second per meter square, K to the power minus 4 Kelvin, power 4 minus 4, right? So you must revise this estimate. It's very, very important. Now last law is Wien's displacement law. It also states that the wavelength corresponding to which the energy emitted by a perfect black body is maximum is inversely proportional to its absolute temperature. The energy emitted by a perfect black body corresponds to different wavelength. Then the wavelength corresponding to which the energy emitted by a perfectly black body is maximum is directly proportional to its absolute temperature. This lambda m is the wavelength corresponding to maximum energy radiated by a black body is inversely proportional to its temperature. It means lambda mt is constant. This is Wien's displacement law. Then after that, a small definition is there. What is greenhouse effect? You must know about greenhouse effect, right? It is the phenomenon which keeps the earth's surface warm at night. So you study by yourself in detail about greenhouse effect, right? So with this, please take a screenshot of this one first, right? Okay, so with this, I am going to end my class. Hope you like this one-shot series of class 11th physics. If you like, then please don't forget to subscribe my channel. Okay, students? So keep revising and stay tuned with this channel. Thank you.